guests is Michael Levine. Michael is a former agent for the Drug Enforcement Agency and has written a new book about 25 years with that agency called Deep Cover, the inside story of how DEA infighting, incompetence, and subterfuge lost us the biggest battle of the drug war, a much-discussed nonfiction book. Michael Levine, thank you for joining us.
Why'd you write it? Pardon me?
Why'd you write it?
Kim is one of the reasons I wrote it. She's one story of millions of very ugly stories going on in this country because of an alleged drug war that is a fraud. Not only is it a fraud, it's an intentional fraud perpetrated by people in a bureaucracy
who know
it's a fraud. Deep Cover details a story step by step.
Why would someone knowingly do it? Why do they do this?
Well, you take William Von Raab's statement when he resigned his commission, angrily resigned his commission as Commissioner of Customs. In a letter to President Bush, he said, third world banking schemes are more important than winning a drug war. Now, that's the Commissioner of Customs. Now, if you consider that the Andean nations have a combined $42 billion world debt, and all the money they get comes from the sale of cocaine, I could just see the bankers in this country pushing to win a drug war.
You were an undercover agent?
For 25 years.
Did you have to take drugs?
I only took drugs once, and I taught thousands of officers undercover. I worked for DEA. I'm considered their number one expert in an article in 1986.
How did Kim not take? Well, how do you explain
it? It's the phenomenon that the government is trying to push on everyone. I think Kim swallowed it a little bit, and that is that we're a victim of drugs. My brother was a heroin addict for 19 years and then killed himself. He chose to take drugs. I chose not to. Mm-hmm.
But how do you work, Kim? How can you be undercover and not? I mean, you're sitting in a room, guys are taking drugs, what do you do?
Larry, I lived 3 months with a motorcycle gang in Buffalo, New York. I never took a drug.
How do you fake it?
You don't fake it. You don't have to fake it. If you choose, what I would tell every narcotic officer who worked for me is that the only time you take drugs is when you're sure that your life is in danger. Chris Hoban in New York, New York City patrolman, whom I dedicated Deep Cover to, among others who died in this drug war, chose not to. He said there was a gram of cocaine by, and the suits in New York had an edict. Now, this is an edict written by people who don't do undercover like I do, like Kim does, like all these other people do. The suits wrote a law that says undercovers are not to take drugs under any condition.
Suits are the boss.
The suits are the bosses. A particular type of boss, an administrative type who sits and directs a drug war from the very safe vantage point of behind a desk.
Where's the suit?
That's a suit. Chris Hoban, thinking of his job, chose not to take dope, and he was killed instantly. But what I teach narcotic undercovers is no case. We're not going to win this drug war. I was overseas, and I saw that we're in bed with the biggest drug dealers alive. The guys sending in tons, like Noriega, we're in bed with them. So you undercover agents, who I'm teaching, I'm telling you, from Mike Levine, who was there in South America, if you have to take dope, just walk out. I don't want to do the case. No case is worth it.
Were you taught wrong?
I was taught what was necessary to survive.
But as you listen to Michael, what do you think?
Well, I think you're talking about two different types of investigations, first of all. DEA buys large quantities of drugs most of the time, where it's acceptable to pull out a test kit.
Not so. Everett Hatchett died in a one-ounce deal.
A one-ounce is not a big deal. I'm talking multiple times.
I'm saying Everett Hatchett died. Okay. Everett Hatchett's a DEA.
Are you surprised that her police agency told her
to jail. People who told her to take dope should go to jail, just as the Americans who looked the other way while Noriega trafficked in drugs should go to jail, because that's conspiracy. The people who told her to take dope are as guilty of conspiracy as anyone else.
They were telling me what they were told and what people before them were told.
I'd like to know. I've taught thousands of undercover agents. I've been teaching since 1975 for DEA.
What police department was this, Kim?
Tyler.
Tyler, Texas.
Yes, and
Plano. You think that's a smaller police department than
a community of about 90,000.
Okay. Yeah. You don't think the New York City Police Department would tell its undercover agents to take
Not officially. Not officially, no. But if you're in a buy-bust situation where you're just walking in, one-time deal, I'm going to buy drugs from you and arrest you on the spot. It's a different situation than if I'm in an apartment for a period of 3 months or 6 months with an assumed identity and buying drugs day after day.
You're talking about the bottom of the drug world, Larry. If we're in this for real, you shouldn't be dealing at the bottom.
That's
right. if you believe in what these politicians in suits are telling us, that we're going for the source, then you don't deal down there. I tell every agent who I've ever trained, if it comes to you buying, if it comes to you risking your life, your family, or your job, let the case go, because our leaders are in bed with 1,000 Noriegas. That's what deep cover is all about.
Kim
people like this should not be doing. Yes.
I think so.
Yeah. I wish Kim had been in my class. I wish Chris Hoban had been in my class.
About,
he'd be alive today.
How about Kim's thoughts that you're losing the war, legalize it?
Absolutely not.
You would not legalize.
Absolutely not. I'll tell you what. Look, in a sense, prohibition was a success, because during the years of prohibition, all the ills related to alcohol dropped drastically. But America did not want alcohol illegal. So Volstead Act voted out. Immediately, all the ills related to alcohol skyrocketed. The same thing will happen if you legalize drugs. And how do you legalize crack? How do you legalize angel dust? How do you legalize PCP? How do you legalize LSD? What do? Give it away? Have companies give it
but
away?
But if you come on and tell us that Bill Bennett isn't doing a good job, that this is kind of fraudulent, you've said that George Bush is just posturing, right?
Have
you said
that? We've had two societies win drug wars, and we're not even looking at what they did. China in 1949 had 70 million heroin addicts. By 1952, they had none. They used all their resources, giving the druggies just what they want. You want treatment on demand? Well, we as a society demand you as a druggie get into an institution and clean up. Once they were detoxed, they went out on the street and were monitored. They went back on drugs, back in. Within 3 years, the market was removed from the street. There was no supply because there was no demand.
And they weren't receiving criminal penalties for having a heroin addiction. That's a form of legalization in itself. That's exactly what I'm saying. Instead of locking people up in jail, give them treatment.
Kim, wherever legalization or any form of it.
But that was a form, what she's saying. They gave the addicts heroin in China.
No, absolutely not.
Well, how did
they were put in treatment.
They were put in mental institutions with no heroin. They were completely detoxified. All China's resources were spent getting the market off the street.
Well, we ask our citizens to come forward, don't we?
Our citizens now are at a point, according to polls, where they're ready to give up their civil rights. You don't have to give up your civil rights to
do
this.
Let me get a break and we'll be joined. Our guests are former police officer Kim Wozencraft, author of the novel Rush, published by Random House. Former DEA agent Michael Levine, author of the new book Deep Cover, published by Delacorte. His agent, by the way, Richard Pine, we congratulate him. He had a 6-pound, 9-ounce baby boy today. And joining us here at our studios in Washington, Dewey Stokes of the Fraternal Order of Police. It's always good to have Dewey with us.
Thank you, man.
Dewey, your thoughts on what we've heard so far?
Well, I think there's a couple things. One, I think you have to determine what is a street narcotics officer and a deep cover narcotics officer. And I think also the training. And then I think you have to go back to the time that Kim entered the police department, and I understand it was in the late 70s, 76, 79. I think there's been some tremendous changes in that period of time in the training of police officers in the narcotics field. And I think they've differentiated between what's a major dealer, a drug dealer, a deep undercover. I know personally no officers. I worked 11 years in intelligence and organized crime. I know officers that worked deep cover, that worked in motorcycle gangs, never got hooked on drugs, never used drugs. I think it's the training of the officers. The policies are that that you don't use drugs.
Are you saying, Dewey, that Kim was trained wrongly or poorly?
Well, she was either trained poorly, was not aware of what was going on. She came from a small police department, she said, in Tyler, Texas. I believe it's about 80 or 90 police officers. She became emotionally involved with her partner. They became part of the group. She went deep undercover without any previous real police training. I don't know whether she went to a police academy prior to entering the police department or not, and obviously got bad information.
Kim, you want to respond?
Maybe I did get bad information, but as I said, I don't know a single narcotics officer from Texas, from my personal experience, who hasn't at some time had a drug problem or an addiction.
I don't know how many drug officers she knows, but I'm like Mike. I've been on the department 23 years, and I know several narcotics officers, worked with some. I don't know any that were definitely hooked on drugs. And that's not to say that throughout this country that we don't have narcotics officers been hooked on drugs or went bad because of the scum that they deal with.
How about
it's easy to get infected.
How about Michael's contention that a lot of this is, or most of it is political baloney, that we're not really doing anything, just making hay?
Well, I think Michael's judging it from what he's seen in the foreign countries. And it's obvious that the situation in foreign countries, and I agree with what he's saying about the economics of the situation, when 60% of the drugs that are grown in foreign countries, or 60% of all the drugs from foreign countries are consumed in the United States, it's definitely a war of economics. I mean, that's what we got going on in Colombia right now. The Colombian farmers would quit growing poppy if we'd go back to letting them grow coffee and guarantee them a lousy $2,000 a year on their coffee fields, they'd quit growing poppy. But at the same time, DEA is down in Colombia doing work. We cannot get ATF agents down there to control the flow of weapons into Colombia. So it's a two-pronged deal. We've got to attack it from both sides, not only domestically, but foreign-wise.
How's William Bennett doing, in your opinion?
Well, I think William Bennett would do a much better job if the bureaucrats would get away from him and let him do some of the issues that he initially started out to do. I think he's been sidetracked on some of them due to politics, quote unquote.
Michael?
And we have to make a decision in this country whether we are going to win the war. I think the first battle that we won was in Panama and bringing Noriega back.
Oh,
but I think we shouldn't start and shouldn't stop there.
Oh, you don't agree with that, Michael?
William Bennett claimed Panama as part of the victory, and that is such a lie. As a supervising drug agent, if I conducted an operation to arrest a mid-level drug dealer, and I've arrested many much bigger than Noriega, and we knew Noriega's in drugs for 20 years, and I lost one agent during the operation and hurt one innocent civilian, I'd be under investigation for the rest of my life for running a maniac's operation. Now, to arrest one mid-level drug dealer, we lost 23 Americans and anywhere from 400 to 6,000 innocent Panamanians. That's insanity. And that's why I wrote Deep Cover, because if you read it, you'll see that we're heading toward a military war like Vietnam under the banner of drug war. Panama was a colossal failure. And wake up, America, before we're in a real war under the banner of drug war.
I'll let Dewey respond, but let me get a break, Dewey, and we'll come right back. And we'll also include your phone calls. Our guests are Kim Wozencraft. The book is Rush, published by Random House. Michael Levine, the book Deep Cover, published by Delacorte. Dewey Stokes, top official with the Fraternal Order of Police. Among the guests next week, George Will talks about his first love. We're going to go to your calls now for Kim Wozencraft, author of Rush, Michael Levine, author of Deep Cover, and Dewey Stokes of the Fraternal Order of Police. The caller will not identify the city, but he is in Illinois. Hello.
Yeah, I'd like to agree with Michael for one. I definitely believe that the government is frauding us out, for one. And for two, the question I have is, what can one person do when he knows for sure that there are a few cops on his force involved in drugs himself?
All right, let's Dewey, you're with the Fraternal Order of Police. What would you do?
Well, the first thing you do is, obviously, police officers have internal affairs units, and those people should be reported to the department, to the internal affairs, or if the officer or the civilian feels better reporting it to the civilian aspect of the department, they should report it to the civilian aspect of it. But they don't have to identify themselves, and they do not have to step forward and testify. It's up to the department to catch that person.
Michael?
You're going to see corruption at this point is really a bigger epidemic than drugs, and part of it is that policemen are starting to understand how fraudulent the whole thing is. There's a great disdain for our whole country's drug war. I'm doing an article on corruption that's going to open a lot of people's eyes.
You mean cops are now wary of
cops? Cops know that
you haven't been on the force in a long time, Kim, would you? But you'd agree with that?
I know that in Plano, Texas, they're still putting cops undercover on the street level, and they're still going out buying drugs, and from what I hear, they're still using drugs.
Missoula, Montana, hello.
Yeah, how you doing, Larry?
Hi.
You know, I'd like to ask this lady just a few questions here real quick.
Go ahead.
Number one, I'd like to know if the person she was trained with ever got hooked to.
Yes.
Number one.
Yes.
And if she was paid. And, you know, was she a snitch, or was she an undercover agent.
I was a police officer.
You know, there's a big difference between just being a snitch and an undercover agent.
Yes.
I mean, was she, you know, was she trained? Actually trained, and these people that trained her went out on the job with her and watched her do this. Because as the one gentleman said, you don't train people, even in the 70s, to do the drugs.
I have to beg to differ. I was a police officer, I was a sworn law enforcement officer, and I was trained by the police department to do drugs.
And they went out with you and showed you how to do it?
Yes.
But did she receive, Larry, any training prior to going on to the police department? I think that's what the gentleman's getting at. Did she receive any training there? And the guy that showed her to do drugs or taught her to do drugs, there was an affection between the two of them immediately, the way I understand it. And she got hooked on drugs with him, and she said he was already a drug abuser. So, I mean, you cannot condemn the entire police department of Tyler, Texas, or the Texas Police Department. And I understand it was some of the police officers that started to talking about her episodes that led to the investigation by the FBI that led to the arrest and the apprehension of her and her partner on civil rights violations and the dismissal of all the drug cases.
You're confusing, I think, a little bit my novel with real life.
Well, your novel is fiction.
Yes.
You know, that's what the novel's headed, fiction. And I think here we're dealing in reality. Here we're dealing in reality. And I don't want the public to come across as condemning all narcotics officers
that's
out there not doing their job.
I'm not condemning all narcotics officers. I'm saying that I personally was trained as a narcotics officer that it is necessary to do drugs in a long-term undercover street-level investigation.
And it was bad training.
You look vexed.
That was bad training.
Larry, the irony of this whole thing just hit me. In Deep Cover, I describe the actual statements made by our government officials about the drug war, and people who read it think it's fiction. And
Oakdale, Louisiana. Hello.
Tim, for you to sit there and say what you did about prison life, I think it's just another way of you trying to cover up your inadequacies to deal with the situation that you were put in. When you ask a convict in prison what they're in for, you know, most of them are going to lie to you to begin with. We don't spend $30-something a day keeping people locked up for selling one kilo of cocaine or whatever. There's too much money involved for that, because, you know, that might be what is on their actual sentence. But you find out for real life that they were arrested for 50 kilos, but they plea bargained down to 1 kilo. You know, you don't, you know, the people are not put in jail for selling 1 kilo of cocaine. And, you know, for you to sit there and try to put across to the American people that convicts are going to tell you the truth when you ask them what they're doing in jail, it's just another misconception about what goes on.
Yeah, I think you're right. Convicts do often lie, but it's my experience that if I ask someone and they wanted to lie to me about it, they would increase the amount, not decrease it. Mm-hmm. They're talking to a fellow convict trying to impress them.
We'll be right back with some more of Dewey Stokes, Kim Rosencraft, and Michael Levine. And we'll close our program with a few moments with Don Parker. Well, back to the call. San Luis Obispo, California. Hello.
Yes, I was a narcotics officer for the state of California for 10 years, and I worked with literally hundreds of local officers throughout the state, and I never ran into a situation where local officers or myself used drugs while working an undercover investigation. And I worked undercover investigations almost for my entire career, and it was, I think your guest, Kim, was very poorly trained, and just something a professional narcotics officer working undercover would not put himself in that situation at all.
I hear from you the same kind of line that I was saying myself when I worked undercover. No, I've never used drugs. No, I don't have a drug problem. And it sounds to me like the standard line. I hope that you didn't have to use drugs, but I find it hard to believe.
Michael?
Kim was only in one police force and only underwent training from one group of people. Mm-hmm. So it's impossible to be able to say that all undercover agents must take drugs. I've trained thousands, and for the most part, if they're trained adequately, they know that the drug war is bogus. They know that nothing is worth their job or their life. The only time I took drugs is literally with a gun on me, locked in an apartment.
Cullen County, Texas. Hello.
Yes. I'm a former narcotics officer for 4 years and worked deep undercover, and I know about Kim's past history. I want to tell her that she misrepresents Texas narcotics agents greatly. and that Texas narcotics officers are not taught to use drugs, and that she became involved with this person. There's more to the story than what she's telling, and that people don't have to use drugs to make cases.
People don't always, in every circumstance, have to use drugs to make cases. I was in situations, just as Michael talks about, where it was a needle in your arm or taking the drugs or a bullet in your head. I was living a few blocks away from the New York City officer who was killed last year or a year and a half ago when he was thrown in at the last minute. There are times when you do have to take drugs, and in my experience, they're
frequent.
Doesn't
the caller understand that? Couldn't you see a situation where an agent would have to take drugs, caller?
Okay, I've been in those same situations. I've had those kind of circumstances.
And what do you do?
And you do not have to take drugs.
Well, like, what do you do?
Just as your other speaker said, you don't have to use them to make the case.
I can get what the way officers are trained, the way I would train an officer is, I've dealt with the biggest drug dealers alive, and one of them was Marcelo Ibanez in 1979, who worked for Roberto Suarez, and they were selling a ton a month. Marcelo, when I offered him drugs with the okay of the U.S. government, turned it down. He said, I don't use this stuff. I work with Richard Burdine. The idea is, if you say, I just don't use
well,
it,
then what
and
you
they
mean?
Say,
you're
you back, you back out.
Only, is
hey, man, look, if I got to take drugs, if I got to take this stuff to buy it from you, bye. I'll go someplace else, period. Walk out fast. And
you're
that's
talking,
what
you're talking
and
Mike, about high-level dealers.
I'm talking
there.
About any level where you've got
any
to,
level.
You walk out. And now,
do
I,
we?
Like I said,
you know, Larry, and when you get into this and you deal drugs on the street, the drug dealer on the street, we got people, and, you know, a majority of the drug buys are made by controlled informants that are working off another charge on them drug, on them street-level deals. Most of the time, that's who actually goes in and consummates, and then you get a search warrant to go in and take the house or the location off, or the crack house. I got to go back that, Kim, I'm sorry, but you know, you got into law enforcement and given law enforcement a black eye, and the Texas law enforcement officers a black eye, because you were poorly trained, and I think you became emotionally involved with your partner, which is a number one sin in police work. You know,
Tom's, let me get quickly. Tom's River, New Jersey. Hello.
Hello, Larry. Unlike the previous callers, I'm not involved in either side of this business, and I can see how the law enforcement people are getting pretty upset. I'm just a prudent taxpayer watching tax dollars go down the drain. I'm concerned about the enormous amount of funds that are going being used to fund this war.
That's what Michael is talking about in his book, right?
You know,
waste of money, right?
Absolutely right. And if you vote for anyone who uses the phrase war on drugs, you're a fool, because he's lying to you. It's not a war on drugs. Drugs don't shoot, drugs don't fight, drugs don't jump up your nose. If you put us to war against an inanimate subject, well, then you're buying the big lie that it's a military war.
I thank you all very much. Thanks very much. Dewey Stokes of the Fraternal Order of Police. We will do more on this, I guarantee you. Kim Rosenkraft, the author of Rush, and Michael Levine, the author of Deep Cover. These two books are currently out. And of course, Mr. Stokes, an excellent representative of the FOP.